All right, good morning, everyone. This video is going to focus on restraints, what their indications are, when we do and don't want to use them, and a big thing with restraints, documentation. So let's get started. When is it appropriate to use restraints? The first and foremost thing you want to know is that restraints are always going to be the last resort option for your patient. If there is ever anything you can do that is less than restraints, like reorienting your patient, giving them a medication, you're always going to activate that intervention before you activate restraints. So when is it actually time to go ahead and go to restraints? Three big questions. Is your patient a danger to themselves or others? If your patient is actively trying to harm themselves or combative and trying to harm their family members, friends, the team members, anybody else in the room, if you feel like somebody is physically in danger, it is appropriate to use restraints. We want to prevent harm to the patient and to everybody else involved, of course. Second question, are they trying to pull out their IVs, their airway, any drains, any other equipment on them that's vital to their safety? This kind of goes back to the first question in a way because, for example, if the patient is intubated and has an ET tube, they're not able to breathe on their own, but they're trying to pull out that breathing tube. Well, if they pull it out and we lose that airway, that patient could code. That patient could actually die because we don't have a way to ventilate them. So if they're trying to pull things out because they're delirious, disoriented, they don't know what it is appropriate to use restraints in that instance because the patient is a danger to themselves. That's just a specific question to the medical environment that if an NCLEX question asks about, is it appropriate to use restraints? And they tell you in the stem of the question they're trying to pull out one of these types of tubes or devices, it will be appropriate to use restraints. And the last thing is for our delirious patients. This is very common in the intensive care units. Patients don't know where they are. They're afraid of the team and everything that's going on, and they become a huge risk to themselves because they don't know where they are, who they are, what time of day it is. And that's very, very scary. So they begin to try and pull things out, their IVs, their airway, and hurt themselves, hurt the team members because they don't know who you are. So for delirious patients that are a danger to themselves or others, it is appropriate to use restraints. Just remember that we always remove restraints as soon as it's possible. If your delirious patient starts to kind of come around and understand what's going on, if your patient who was a danger to themselves is no longer trying to hurt themselves, always discontinue the restraint order and do other interventions. Redirect them, orient them to the situation. If your provider has sedation ordered, that would be appropriate to give as well to keep them comfortable and safe. We always want to get rid of those restraints just as soon as we can. So let's talk about some of these different types of restraints if you do have to use them. The first one and one of the most common is a soft wrist restraint. This is basically kind of a bracelet that wraps with Velcro and then a clip around the wrist of the patient. It can either be 2 points, meaning just the wrists or just the ankles, or 4 points, which in that case, all four extremities would have one of these devices on them. Those loops then go down and get knotted around an item that cannot move. So for example, you cannot tie these to the bed rail because a bed rail can be moved up and down, and that would negate the effectiveness of the restraint. No chairs, no rolling equipment. It has to be tied to like a loop on the bed itself that cannot move. Most hospital beds have a place where restraints can be tied. So that is the soft wrist restraint. Again, it can be 2 point or 4 point. And then the other picture over on the right here are our mitt restraints or posy mitts. So these are just like big poofy gloves that will go over the finger of your patient and then be Velcroed or clipped around the wrist. This is for your delirious but kind grandma who doesn't know what's going on. So she's trying to take the oxygen off her nose. She's trying to pull her IV off. She's not necessarily violent. She's not trying to hurt herself or harm you. She's just upset because she doesn't know what's going on. She's very confused. And when you put these mitts on her and cover her fingers, it takes away her ability to get those tubes out, pull the oxygen off her face, do whatever it is she's trying to do that is could be a harm to herself. These are probably the most commonly used on some units. They're really the least invasive. There's a low risk of skin breakdown when they're applied correctly. And they're not quite as, you know, they don't look quite as bad to family members because they just kind of look like big poofy gloves that a kid would wear out in the snow. So like I said, we see this commonly on older patients who don't really know where they are and are a bit confused but aren't necessarily violent. All right, last but not least, as I alluded to in the beginning, we're going to spend an entire slide on the documentation of restraints. Because these are a last resort item and they're not really used that often, documentation is paramount. And there's several things that must be documented anytime you're placing a patient in restraints. First and foremost, the start and stop times. You need to document to the minute exactly when this restraint was initiated and when it is stopped, because there's very strict policies about how long they're allowed to be on. Secondly, the reason that the restraints are indicated. You really want to validate why you have had to escalate this patient to being in restraints and why another intervention is not appropriate at this time, because that kind of covers you as far as a nurse saying, yes, these are very much necessary. If they weren't necessary, you would need to discontinue them. Thirdly, the plan of care. This first and foremost goes into the reason the restraints were indicated, but even more importantly, talks about your plan for helping the patient to progress to a place where they don't need restraints. We need to have plan of cares for these patients, all patients, but specifically restraint patients, that move us towards getting out of restraints, because it's very important to limit the amount of time that they are in restraints. The last item that must be documented and documented very, very thoroughly is your assessment. Of course, we document an assessment on all of our patients, but it is especially important when your patient is in restraints because of skin breakdown. If we just leave a patient in restraints for a prolonged period of time and we're not checking on them and looking under the restraints for skin breakdown, you will undoubtedly get pressure injuries and skin breakdown. And the hospital is responsible for that because we caused it. We put this patient in restraints and caused that skin breakdown. Your due diligence as a nurse is to check that skin, look under the restraints, validate that there's two finger breadths width of room between the restraint and the patient's skin, that there's no moisture, redness, that you're giving them bathroom breaks and all of those things that are required of us. And you have to document all of it. So check for that skin breakdown. If you see any redness, you need to initiate preventative measures such as a foam Mepilex, a barrier cream, whatever's appropriate depending on the area that the restraint is on for that patient. If you don't document skin breakdown and the next nurse comes in behind you and sees breakdown already present, you will be held responsible for it. So document, document, document these restraints.
Let's lift your head of your bed up.
Explain to the patient that you are going to apply the elbow device to help her stop picking at her IV line. Place the restraint around your patient's arm so that the elbow joint rests against the padded area. Keeping the elbow rigid, secure the splint with the Velcro straps. Check the fit of the restraint.
How's that feel? Okay, I'm going to go ahead and clip it to your gown just to be...
Insert patient's hand inside the mitt palm down. Separate the patient's fingers so that each finger fits into its own slot. Wrap the wrist strap around the smallest part of the patient's wrist through the plastic ring and then secure with the hook and loop fastener. Slide one finger, flat, between the cuff and the inside of the patient's wrist to assure a proper fit. The strap must fit properly.
First, position the cuff on the patient's limb. Then wrap and secure it with the contact closure. Second, wrap the web cuff strap around the limb. Overcuff and secure it with plastic quick release buckle. Now, adjust the web strap snugly around the cuff. Always allow enough room to insert one finger between the patient's limb and the cuff. Be sure that the straps do not interfere with or cut off circulation. Next, release the buckle on the long end of the web strap. Wrap the loop end of the strap around the bed frame. Make sure this is the movable part of the bed frame. Slip the buckle through the loop to secure it to the bed. Now snap the two parts together. Make sure the buckle snaps together tightly. Extend or shorten the strap on the bed frame as needed to secure in desired location. To release the buckles, just squeeze the sides of the quick release buckle and pull it apart.
So, to get started, the first thing you want to do is to make sure that you attach it to the bed frame first. If you don't, there's these belt buckles that can fly around. You attach it to someone's hand first, you're gonna catch a belt buckle to the head, okay? So for your safety, make sure that you're attaching it to the bed frame first. So if you come on over here, I'll show you how to do that. You're gonna attach it to the bed frame. You don't wanna do it to the rail, obviously, any movable object. You wanna do it to the bed frame. So there's a buckle here. You're just gonna run it through the buckle. Up to the hand. And our nice patient has been properly sedated. So I'm gonna lock it up there and just push it and click it to lock it. Next thing I'm gonna do is attach it to her hands. So this is really, really easy. This is much easier than it was before. So you're gonna do black to black, blue to blue. And then last step is one last strap. And, press to lock.
Can you get out?
No.
Are you to behave now?
No.
Okay.
So with violent restraints, just like any other restraint, same rules apply, right? We need to be checking for distal pulses. Make sure it's not too tight. Make sure that they have still some wiggle room in here. That net's not too tight, cutting off their circulation. So, big things with this is do not use the old leather ones. These neoprene ones are our violent restraints. Always secure it to the bedpost first. Don't secure it to the patient. You can get hit by a stray belt buckle. When you have it on the wrist, it's really easy. Black to black, blue to blue, and then strap.